growth.
That's not the end.
No, there's way more where that came from. Yeah, give it up for Devon.
That guy right
stroke his ego a little bit. Oh my gosh. Okay.
Come back.
One second. So let's. We have more chairs somewhere. Do we have more chairs?
Grab some chairs.
Let's add to this side a little bit. So if you guys could squish back. Squish back. I don't words.
Adult
just,
leaders
like,
get
move
in there
back a little
too.
Bit, make room.
Everybody get in there.
Everybody take a seat.
Adult students, but stay tuned for the continuation of that
Devon
series.
Yeah, Devon eats some cereal, and it is a wild ride to getting there. So you, come back.
You might laugh. You might cry.
I cried a lot today making those videos.
Yeah, it was devastating.
Okay, before we continue, my name is Nikki,
and I'm DeWayne.
And we are here.
We're here. Together we form Megatron.
Yeah, okay.
That one didn't hurt like the one the other week did. That one hurt.
I
appreciate that one.
It's okay. Welcome to Primetime.
Welcome to Primetime.
How many of you, this is your first time here tonight? Don't be afraid. Raise it high.
This is my first time. They put me on stage.
How many of you were dragged here by your friend? Jung, put your hand down. James
Johnson brought me here.
James. So tonight is not just any normal prime time.
No, it's
actually,
not.
Actually, in case you thought it was.
Tonight is my hope, and you guys throughout this night will start to understand what my hope is and what it means to us. And we're excited about that.
Yeah. Yep. And kind of get to see what the purpose of prime time is and why we meet weekly. It kind of all comes out tonight. So be grateful that your friend brought you, because it's about to get crazy awesome. So before we get into the fun stuff, we've got a couple of announcements for you.
We do have some announcements. First of which is, hey guys, how many of you have been rock climbing before?
It's fun.
For those of you that don't know, before I came here, I was actually a rock climbing coach. Still am. I am stupid strong, if you didn't know. Yeah, I'm humble too. But
not as strong as me.
Next week, because we are not having prime time, we are going to have a hangout at the edge. We're going to do some rock climbing. It is a Super Bowl. We're going to do this at 2:30.
Yep.
So if you have any interest in rock climbing and hanging out with some awesome people like Nikki and myself,
I'm the best.
We will be at the edge at 2:30.
Yep, 2:30 to 4:30.
4:30.
Yep.
And bring $15. And come enjoy some rock climbing.
Yeah,
I will show you how strong Nikki is.
I'm pretty strong.
Oh, yes.
Oh yeah, and you have to fill out
a waiver. If you have not been to the climbing gym before, make sure you go to the website edgehalfmoon.com, fill out a waiver, and I will be very appreciative.
Yeah, just to clarify, we won't be meeting here at 6:30 next
correct.
Week because we will all be watching football because Super Bowl.
Go Niners.
I don't really care who wins.
Brett's not here. But that was for Brett, if you didn't know.
Brett loves the Niners. So we won't be here, but we will be at the edge at 2:30.
Yes.
So be there.
Come hang out.
Or be square. Next announcement is, again, at the edge. We have another event at the edge.
But a little different here.
It's a different event. Yep.
So we're not actually rock climbing at this event. We are just hanging out at the gym. So if you guys didn't know, Grace Fellowship is a part of four campuses, three of which have youth groups.
Mm-hmm.
So we are going to get together with those other two youth groups and hang out, play some games in the gym, play some games in the cafe, Nintendo Switch, if you guys know what that is.
That's cool.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
So 6th grade through 12th grade. So pretty much everyone in this room, you're welcome to come.
Yes, that one is at no cost.
No cost.
Come out, hang out. We would love to have you guys. I want Half Moon to outnumber Latham and Saratoga. Is it... Everything is a contest, and we must win.
Competition.
So
we're the best.
Everybody be there.
February 16th, 6 to 9 at the Edge. February 16th. Okay. Last announcement, and my favorite announcement, personally. Winter Retreat is coming up. Yeah, give it up for Winter Retreat. That's right. If you don't know. I'm like a dying chicken. If you don't know what Winter Retreat is, basically we all get in a bus, go to a campsite, and have a heckin' party. This time it's at Camp of the Woods. So we're gonna, it's a bunch of fun mixed with a bunch of like a big huge sleepover, and food. Pretty much all your dreams come true, really.
It's
my favorite weekend of the year.
Come hang out with your friends and some kind of cool adults, as cool
they're
as
the coolest
can be.
They're the coolest.
Yeah,
let's be real.
Okay.
It is February 28th through March 1st, and it is $165 to go, but we have all the monies to cover you if you need a scholarship.
We have all the monies. So I have been talking to people in the church, and they want you guys to go to this retreat. They want you guys to go to this retreat so bad that they are throwing money at me for
you
to go.
Wouldn't you love to have somebody just throw money at you? That'd be pretty sick.
This money is designated for each and every one of you. If you guys have any concerns about going, any hesitation about going because of money, talk to me. Do not let that be a reason, because I will give you money.
Yeah.
I will give you $165.
We'll pay you to go.
$165.
Yeah.
No plus.
Talk to us at the end. We have a sign-up sheet downstairs if that's something that's interesting to you. Put your name down, and DeWayne will email you and your parents with more information about that.
Yes,
this week.
I will talk to whoever I need to talk to.
We have a deadline.
February 9th.
February 9th. So if you want to go to Winter Retreat, this is for high school. Middle school, your chance is coming later. But for high schoolers, your last chance to, I almost said audition. You don't have to audition. You can just sign up.
Just show.
Sign up to go to Winter Retreat is February 9th. So that's 2 weeks from now?
2 weeks from now.
So put your name down.
Talk to me.
You want to be there. Trust me.
Message to Primetime Instagram, whatever you need to do. Any form of communication that works for you.
Cool. Okay, that's all we have for announcements, which means...
Should we play a game?
We can play a game, DeWayne.
Let's play a game.
Okay.
Is there an empty chair?
Let's turn up... turn up the lights. Oh, he's so cool. Wow, DeWayne. Wow.
So much jumping and power. That was like my superhero stuff.
So we're going to play kind of a crazy game. I'm actually going to ask if everyone right here can just scoot your chairs back a little bit so that we make more of an oval instead of a whatever this is.
Can't touch him, Maddie.
Peanut. That's the word. That's the word I was looking for. Okay, so this game is called Tsunami.
What?
DeWayne. Take it away.
So it's called Tsunami because the goal is to get you guys moving in a chaotic direction. So what we're going to do now is, let's say I say a word or a phrase. So I want you to switch chairs if you go to Shen.
So everyone who goes to Shen would stand up and you'd have to find a new chair. It cannot be the chair directly next to you, Sam and Luke.
Big fact.
I saw it. Yeah, see? Okay.
Right here, Ryan.
There you go.
Perfect.
Oh, they're still running.
There's one there.
There's so many people.
There's
that
one here.
It's going to be really funny.
This is going to be great. I'm going
to
get
run
over.
Did you ask me where are my shoes? I don't know. Who knows? Actually, they're right behind you.
So, does everybody understand that rule?
Does everyone get it? Okay. The only real rule is that you can't take the seat of the person next to you if they get up at the same time as you. Because that's just dumb.
So, quick question.
Yeah.
What happens if I say tsunami?
Everybody, get your little butts up and run to a new chair. That's what it is. Okay?
All right.
That was fun. I'm glad you all reacted to that. Okay, so does everybody understand how to play the game? If you're lost, you're lost. I can't really help you. Okay, so... I would like you to stand up and run and find a new chair if you're wearing black of any kind. Or a tsunami. And then everybody is going to get up and find a new chair, but the only difference is that there's one less chair. So you can lose, okay? And then you have to speak into the mic. So, punishment. Yeah. Bethany, what would you like to say?
You're wearing boots.
Get up! Move! You don't want to be the last person to find the chair! You don't want to be the last person. Oh, Alicia was so sly in that moment. That was amazing.
It's Denise.
Denise!
Curly hair.
Oh, that's me! Denise, you gotta find a new chair! Denise!
You know,
nope, Denise, get up, you gotta do it again.
Back in the day, that would have been me. Back when I had hair.
I really have a hard time believing that, but okay. If you're wearing pants, get up! Might as well just say tsunami. TJ, Sam, there's a chair! It's over there, it's over there! Go, go, go! Oh, we know how much TJ loves to speak into the microphone.
If you're wearing green,
it's okay. Wait, Gwen, what's happening?
How did you end up outside
there's
the circle, Gwen?
There's an empty chair right now that one of you need to get. How did she get outside of the circle?
Gwen, over
Gwen,
here.
You're magical.
Gwen over
find
here.
The empty chair.
Over here. I want to see some hustle. Gwen, run.
Bryce is like in there.
Or walk. Walk. Okay, that works.
Okay, Bryce, your turn.
If you're wearing a hat.
Go! Sit down! Oh!
If you breathe.
Oh! Chelsea's like, I don't breathe! Breathe! Chelsea, I just wanna interview Chelsea real quick. Chelsea. So if you don't breathe, what do you do?
Did she not move?
I have gills.
She has gills.
Hunter gets her hair.
Technically, gills are still breathing. No, she just thought he said read. She don't read.
If you're bald.
The chair.
No!
Damn, Packard.
You got jeans on.
Okay, wait, here's the question. Do these count as jeans?
I think so, yeah.
Because they're black, but they're jeans.
Are they denim?
Okay, I'm going to this side. Why are we both on the same side? What'd you just say to me?
Hey, you got shoes on.
Shoes on.
I don't. Shoes are for the weak.
Tsunami. gotta
make
be a good one.
One.
This is a lot of pressure.
What?
Tsunami.
Winner, she means loser.
No, I'm
yes,
a winner.
Proud of you.
Okay. So, the chair that you are currently sitting in, could you please pick it up, move it, turn it around so that you're facing the stage and kind of more condensed in the center? Joel.
If you want to find your friend that invited you, move your chair towards them.
Who littered? Who's Capri Sun? Gabby!
Great job. So now, I want to invite you to direct your attention to my good friends, Kayla and Joseph. They will be leading us in worship, so please give them your attention. Please be polite, don't pull out your phones, and pay attention.
Awesome, let's stand. So good to see you all tonight. We're gonna sing some songs. But first I wanna just pray really quick. As you are in church, and we are here for one reason and one reason alone. So let's bow our heads together. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much, God, that you are a God of love, and God, that you are a God of hope, and of peace, and of joy. God, we just declare that you are God alone tonight. God, we declare your name over everything, and we just pray that you would be glorified above everything else that we do tonight. God, we love you and we praise you in Jesus' name.
Tore through the shine.
sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe, and out of the silence of the roaring lion, declared the grave has no claim on me. No, it doesn't. Never will. Sing, then came the morning. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. to talk about this next song that we're going to sing. It's called Highlands. Some of you have heard it before. Some of you haven't heard any of these. And I'm so glad that you're hearing them now. But I want to just kind of talk about this song for just a second in its grand scheme of what it might mean. There's a lot of words, a lot of different things to think about. But the chorus says, I will praise you on the mountain, and I will praise you when the mountain's in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I will praise you in the valleys all the same. So let's break that down really quick. So we can have these highs and these lows in both our walk with life and our walk with our relationship with Christ. So whether you know the Lord or whether you haven't gotten there yet, we both know the highs and lows equally. I think that's fair to say. We're both living the same life. We know what it feels like to be at your best, to feel at your most confident, and to be going towards what you really want to go towards, and you feel yourself moving towards that. And then we feel at our lowest when those insecurities bump in and those doubts bump in and those grades get low, and it's really, really difficult to kind of find the common ground there. But I hope that what you find tonight, whether it's through this time that we have right now, whether it's through a game, whether it's through a conversation that you have with somebody today, I pray that you would find that the common ground between that is that reckless love of God. It's that thing that meets us where we are. It's that feeling of hope and peace and joy, regardless of what we're going through, regardless of what we think is happening in our lives. So as we sing this, I want you to recognize that God is the same in both those highs and those lows, because he's our balance. He's the thing that keeps us moving forward. He's the thing that keeps us walking through either the valley or climbing up that mountain. So in whatever circumstance you walked into this room with, whether you were brought by a friend or whether you are a student leader and you've been here a billion and a half times, I want you to believe that truth, not only for the person next to you, but for yourself. I really, really, really want to see that come to life today. Can we do that? Yeah, do it in. the same. Well, you guys can be seated.
Thank you. That was incredible. So now we are going to transition, and a video is going to come up. And in this video, there is going to be a pretty old guy. This old guy is Billy Graham. Billy Graham, his entire really purpose on this earth, he passed away recently, was to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what this video is about. So while you may think, hey, this guy's old, he doesn't relate to me, there are people in this video who will relate to you, and we have people that are going to be sharing later that will relate to you. So please just pay attention, be respectful, please keep your phones away, just to not disturb the people around you. Thank you.
On our churches, we have a cross. It's embossed on our Bibles, on our Bibles.
I thought the cross was a relic. It was a medallion on a necklace at best.
It's an ornament that we wear around our necks, Christians and non-Christians.
The cross really didn't have any meaning to me except for something artistic that rock stars wore.
But talk about the depth and the real meaning of the cross, and it becomes an offense. Why is that?
The cross is offensive because it confronts people. Even so, it's a confrontation that all of us must face.
I was really hurting and just didn't understand the source of all my pain and problems. I spent my whole life just burdened for something. Hungering for something, thirsting after, chasing this thing that I couldn't put my finger on ultimately. I was abused by older people, some in the family, some outside of the family. So as I got older, I always talked back, I always got into fights. My whole world was surrounded by guns and drugs and gangs. I remember in front of all my friends, just telling them to watch this, and as a lady was driving down the street, I jumped in the middle of the street and pointed the gun right at her, just to see her panic and freak out. And it was just me seeking power.
My mom always told me about God. I think I had an idea that God was big and good, but as time went on and I saw more and more tragic things happen around me, I think that was the beginning of me just questioning everything about life and about God. When I was 10 years old, my stepdad came to pick me up and he said that my cousin Kelly was dead. I remember being so mad and really just deciding that if God was big and good, why wouldn't he protect my cousin, who is so tiny and so awesome, such a funny, brilliant little guy? Why wouldn't God protect him from a huge muscle guy like his stepdad, who beat him to death?
I look out across an audience when I stand up to preach, and I think of all the people with their different backgrounds and their various needs. And I know that they are objects of God's mighty love. To the point that he gave his son, his only son, to die upon a cross. And the cross was the most terrible form of execution by the Romans for criminals. And Jesus endured all that in our place because of our sins. We deserved the cross. We deserved hell. We deserved judgment and all that that means. I know that there are many people that dispute that, People don't want to hear that they're sinners. To many people, it's an offense. The cross is offensive because it directly confronts the evils which dominate so much of this world.
You see, the Bible teaches that all of us are wrong. We've all gone astray. We've everyone turned to his own way. And when we turn to our own way, we go astray from God's way. And that includes the whole human race. And that's why the world is in such terrible danger right now. It's not dangerous so much because we have atomic bombs. It's dangerous because of the human hearts back of the bombs. Filled with envy and hate and strife and greed and lust and all the other things that could pull the trigger.
I remember thinking that same year that my cousin died about the depth of the evil in the world. I never wanted to have kids. It was just a new person to suffer. That was the year I started to cry myself to sleep every night and stopped believing in God. I couldn't get away from my own depression. So I started studying other religions. There was a lot of nice ideas, but there wasn't any tangible healing. And I remember thinking, I'm tired of the pain in my heart. I'm tired of going to bed that way. I'm tired of feeling like a burden. I'm just tired of not knowing why I'm alive. And so I remember the night I laid in bed and I knew I was gonna commit suicide the next day. I knew that I was not gonna live past tomorrow.
By 16, I was getting high on a daily basis and got involved with a woman after woman after woman, and you know, when you mix drugs, you mix alcohol, you mix youth, it's cause for an explosion. My mother was really concerned about me. I remember she just grabbed a Bible and said, I don't know what to do, but you just need to read this Bible. You know, I remember taking the pages of the Bible and just ripping them out and throwing them on the ground and saying, I don't care about your God. I don't care about this. This isn't mean anything to me.
One reason that the cross is a defense to people is because it demands, doesn't suggest, it demands a new lifestyle. In all of us, sin is a disease in the human heart. It affects the mind and the will and the emotions. Every part of our being is affected by this disease. How can we break this bondage? How can we be set free? God helps us break those chains. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things pass away. Everything becomes new. He can make you a totally new person.
On the day that I planned to commit suicide, I came home from school and my grandma was there and she wasn't supposed to be there. And she looked at me and said, there's something wrong with you. You're gonna go to church. I was like, no way I'm going to church. And she screamed at the top of her lungs like we were fighting back and forth, and I just didn't want to listen to her yell anymore. And so I decided, fine, I'll go. And then afterwards, I'll go ahead and follow through with my plan. So I went to the back of the church and slumped down in my chair and hated everybody in the room and the pastor started speaking, and I hated him more than anyone. And he says, there's a suicidal spirit in the room. And of course, all the hair stood up on the back of my neck, and I was, well, this is really weird. And I got up and went to the door. A white-headed man is standing there, and he stopped me. And it was like, the Lord wants me to speak to you. He wants you to know that even though you've never known an earthly father, that God will be a better father to you than any earthly father could ever be. God knows the pain in your heart. He's seen you cry yourself to sleep at night. The idea was so overwhelming to me. He's like, do you want me to pray for you so that Jesus can take the pain out of your heart? He put his hand on my shoulder and started to pray. It was as if the God of the universe showed up right in front of me. And the first thing I noticed was that God was holy and good. And the second thing I noticed was that I was so not holy and not good.
I was in a really dark place. I was really lonely, really depressed. And a friend of mine reached out and invited me to a conference. And I'm thinking, why not? My mind was blown when I got there. I had never seen anything like it. I saw guys with bullet wounds and ex-gang members who loved Jesus. And I had never seen anything like that before. And so I was intrigued. I'll never forget the pastor. You know, he started talking about Jesus. And talking about him in an intense way that I had never thought about before. I had never just imagined Jesus as a real person going through real things. I just kind of thought of him as this fairy, off, distant person. But he brought it home to me, and he started talking about Jesus being beaten and being whipped for a crime he didn't commit, and the skin being ripped off his back, and him having to, in the midst of his pain, carry this cross up this mountain of a skull and being pinned to this cross. It was so vivid and visual to me. It was like I could see this happening to Jesus. And I remember him saying, like, how dare you tough guys call my Jesus a punk? You know, like, look at what he went through. And then the preacher said, do you not know you've been bought with a price? And it just came to a head. It was like, wow.
On that cross, God was laying on Jesus our sins. They not only put nails in his hands, but before that, they scourged him. A Roman scourge was a terrible thing. They took whips and pellets on those whips and beat a person almost to death. And then they took that cross and made him carry the cross, which was, in his weakened condition, was almost impossible. But he carried that cross to a place outside of Jerusalem. And then they put nails in his hands. But that was not the real suffering. The real suffering is when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In that terrible moment, he and God the Father were separated. He shed his blood, and the shedding of that blood carries with it God's very life.
The blood is the meeting place between God and man. And the Bible says without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. And that's what Christ was doing on the cross. He was making atonement for our sins, and he was shedding his blood. Now, when you take the blood out, that means you're giving your life. And that's what it means. It means the life of Christ. The cross and the resurrection of Christ offers forgiveness of sin, offers a whole new life, and offers you eternal life if you come to the cross by repentance and faith.
Jesus literally took all of this on his own back for me. You know, I remember bowing out, just head touching the ground and saying, I'm sorry, God, I'm sorry. But one step led to another, which led to another. And, you know, I was back drinking and sleeping around with women. And the conviction that I was now feeling was so strong. And I remember driving on the highway, just thinking to myself, God, you gotta do something. Because if you don't do something, I might hurt myself or hurt somebody else. I don't know what's gonna happen, but just don't kill me. I get cut off by a truck, and my truck just starts tipping until it flips over and starts rolling fast. The glass is coming in, the windshield cracks. I'm not wearing a seatbelt at all, so I'm kind of floating around the car. And I looked myself over. There was just a piece of glass stuck in my arm, and I pulled it out, and that was it. I said, Lord, I need to get with you. I need you to change me. I need you to really make this real, and I need to stop running from you. I was genuinely trying to know him more and read my Bible and grow. And I really began to be a passionate Christ follower.
But you set me free. I gave you no reason to give me new seasons, to give me new life, new breathing. But you hung there bleeding. You died for my lies and my cheating, my lust and my greed. What is a man?
I realized you don't earn righteousness, that none of us is righteous, not even one, and that our works are like filthy rags to God. Jesus lived the life I could not live and died the death I should have died. You know, that gets me every time, just to think, man, I gain everything. I put my trust in him.
If God had looked at me and said, go away forever, he would have been right. It would have been just as... The same time I felt that, I felt him inviting me to an embrace of grace and love unconditional. It was like God was saying, I love you. I know you're tired of the way you've been living, and I will make you new if you will let me. And my heart was just yes. It just said, yes, I need that. I want that. Please. And that's why I woke up the next day. I just felt such a peace and a joy almost that I'd never felt before. Jesus saved my life, and on top of everything else, the life of my son and the new baby. Wouldn't be if Jesus hadn't intervened and rescued me. And the most overwhelming thing is to think that Jesus became sin, and it was my sin, and it was things that I've done that housed him on the cross. It was things that I've done. He hung naked on a cross, bleeding in a shameful way, so that I would never have to be ashamed for the things that I've done. The truth is, there is no other way besides Christ and what he did. There is no life outside of that.
Yeah.
for them way of salvation except through the cross of Christ. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. The only way to the Father, Father God, is through his Son, Jesus Christ. Now why Jesus? He's the only one that was born into this world without sin. But more than that, he was a righteous one. And when you come to him, you're clothed in his righteousness. God no longer sees your sin. He no longer sees your own heart. He sees Jesus.
Now, I don't understand all about it. There are many things about the cross and about salvation that I do not understand. And I'm not told that I have to understand it all. I'm told that I'm to believe. And anybody can believe. A blind man can believe. A deaf man can believe. An old person can believe. A young person can believe. And that word believe means commit. I commit my life totally to him. Jesus Christ from the cross says, I will save you. I will forgive you. I will change you. I'll make you a new person if you come to the cross by repentance and faith. Come to Christ.
So as we continue, I want you to just stay seated. I want this to be a time of reflection as you focus on what you just watched. Whether you close your eyes, whether you just sit there, I want you to just kind of reflect and think back, just kind of what went through your mind as that video just played. And I want you to listen to these lyrics.
Beneath the surface of my anxious imagination, that is found in you alone. It washes over every doubt, every illness.
So you guys might be sitting there after watching that video and hearing the music, wondering how this relates to your life. And that's what we're here for. Sarah and Francesca have something on their hearts that they want to share with you that shows how God can impact your lives in the same way that he's impacted theirs.
So I grew up in a Christian household, a Catholic church actually. I went to St. Mary's, which isn't too far from here. My parents, we went to church every single Sunday. Like, we were the family, like, we were on vacation, and my mom would, like, try to find a church just because, like, we, you know, we felt like we had to go to church. I knew about God. I knew about Jesus. I knew that he loved me, but I didn't have a relationship with him. I didn't know who he was. In middle school, I struggled with anxiety, and it led into depression. I didn't want anybody to know that I was sad. I would go to school, and I would pretend that I was fine. You know, I always had that, like, bubbly, happy personality. I didn't want anybody to know, because I was embarrassed. As most of you know, I have a twin sister, Brittany. I hate using this word, but she was the popular one in middle school. Everybody knew her, everybody liked her, and I just felt like I was known as Brittany's sister. I felt like I was living in her shadow, and I did not know, but at that time, she was dealing with her own self-image issues, but I never talked about it with her because I was embarrassed. I didn't want her to know. I didn't want anybody to know. My parents, my mom, she used to try to talk to me about God a lot, and she would come in my room at night and we would read the Bible. And I remember almost getting angry with her. I didn't want to hear it. Like, I knew it was the truth. I knew that I wanted it, but I didn't want to hear it. Because I think I felt so guilty. A lot of you probably know, but in middle school, I made YouTube videos. A lot of them, they were makeup videos and fashion videos. And I think I use that as my outlet because it was something that was, like, bigger than I was. It was something that I could be a part of. You know, people at school would watch my videos. I know a lot of people made fun of me for it, and other people were definitely supportive. But I would always hear comments like, "Oh, I watched your video, it was so funny. I didn't want my videos to be funny. They were supposed to be educational about makeup and, like, DIYs. They were really embarrassing." But, I would go home and I would work really hard and I would film a video, and I felt like I was being fake because I was pretending to be happy and I wasn't. I would turn off the camera and I would just cry. I cried myself to sleep all the time. I wondered every single day what it would be like if I wasn't here. I didn't want to be on this earth anymore. I didn't want to take my own life because I was too scared. I had recently lost a cousin to suicide, and I saw how that impacted my family and his parents and how it tore people apart, and I didn't want to do that. I remember one day I was sitting in my basement. I had a little office, and I started writing a note. I wrote what I would want to say to my family if I were to take my own life, what I would want them to know. As I was writing and I heard footsteps coming down the stairs, it was my mom, and I ripped it up and I threw it away. I didn't want her to know. And it was weird. She just came up to me and she hugged me and she told me that she loved me and that God loved me. Looking back, I know that that was God. Sorry. God saved me. I didn't know that that's what I needed at that time, but it was exactly what I needed when I needed it. My friend Taylor invited me to prime time. The first time I came was actually on Halloween, so there wasn't much talk about Jesus, but we came in our costumes and everybody was so welcoming. Like, I could just see like Jesus in them. I was like, wow, like these people are such wonderful people. I want to be like them. And I continued to come back, and I ended up giving my life to Jesus at My Hope, like tonight. And it was so, it's so overwhelming. The God does so many things in our lives that we don't, like, we don't see them in the moment, but we look back and we know that that was God. And all, I know all the things that I went through. I know that they were all for a reason, or God did good things through them. I just want to say, like, something. Depression, for me, was this really weird thing. I knew I wanted to be happy because, you know, that was always the goal. I just wanted to be happy. I hated how I felt. But it was like, at the same time, I almost wanted to be sad. I wanted to cry. It felt good to cry. I wanted to be alone. It's this weird, awful feeling, but I promise you, if you're going through it, it is not forever. You will get through it. The people that invited you here tonight, they invited you because they love you and they care about you. And they know how wonderful the grace of God is, and they want that for you. So, you know, whatever you get out of tonight, whether you are someone that decides to give your life to Christ tonight or not, think about this. Remember this night. This is a special night.
So, like, I've always known Jesus and God. And, like, I knew He died for my sins, and, like, He loves me and all that. And I didn't really go to church that much. I only went on the holidays when I was younger. So when I was younger, I started having suicidal thoughts, and it was really hard for me because I thought I was really ugly. And every day I would just stare at myself in the mirror, and I would just wish that I looked different. And so I wanted to keep going to church and stuff. So I like talked to my friends, and one of my friends actually brought me to church, prime time, the avenue, in middle school. And it was actually on My Hope night, like tonight, that I gave my life to Christ. And He changed my vision, and now I think I am so beautiful, and all of you are so beautiful too, because you are God's creation, and His creations are so beautiful. There's this verse in the Bible that says, you are God's masterpiece. So remember that.
Thank you. That was incredible. You two are awesome. Thank you so much. I actually just want to spend a minute, and I want to share a brief portion of my testimony with you guys. So, much like maybe many of you, I did not grow up in a Christian home. My parents, they had me, and they separated before I could even remember. I lived with my mom during the week and my dad during the weekend. My dad was an alcoholic. My mom never had a stable, healthy relationship with anybody. Neither of them had a relationship with Christ. So it struck me as weird when my dad asked me if I wanted to go to church. He said, hey, do you want to go to Sunday school on Sunday morning? And at the age of 8, I didn't know what that meant. So he dropped me off, and he proceeded to go into town and go to the bar and drink. He would come back, pick me up, and then take me back to my mom's. And that was just what happened until about 10. When I turned 10, I went to an event, and there I really understood what it was like to feel God, experience God in an incredible and life-changing way. And at that moment, I gave my life to Christ. And at that moment, I felt a call on my heart from God to devote my life to doing this, to sharing the love of Christ with people like you. At the age of 10, that is what God called me to do. And I'm so thankful that I'm here doing that. I'm not saying it's been easy. I went to college. I had a friend, close friend of mine, overdose and pass away. And that sucked. I experienced depression where I did not feel God, where I did not understand who God was. But I knew coming out the other side that God loves me and that God is there for me and that God had a plan for me. And if that plan culminates in tonight sharing the love of Christ with you guys, that's great. This is incredible. I'm so thankful for all of you here. I'm gonna turn it back over to Kayla here, and I'm gonna invite her to sing another song. And during this song, I want you guys to really think of what has been spoken to you tonight and what God might be calling you to do.
So now until forever.
guys are here tonight because a friend bribed you to come out here. Maybe this is your first time to primetime. Maybe this is your first time in a church ever. If it is, I'm so glad you're here. I'm so thankful that you guys are here tonight. I'm gonna ask you guys, everybody standing, I'm gonna ask you guys to all close your eyes. Everybody close your eyes right now. And maybe you heard these testimonies tonight. Maybe you heard how God can change your life. And you want to know more about that. You want to know more about how God can change you, how God can work in you. In the video, I talked about how Jesus came, lived a life that we could not live. Jesus lived a perfect life, and he died the death that we deserve. We all deserve hell, myself included. I'm a sinner. We all have issues. We all have things that we're bringing to the table here. But the beauty of the cross is that it takes it from you. The cross takes that burden, takes that sin from you. Now, with everybody's eyes closed, I want to invite you tonight, if you don't know what it means to be a follower of Christ, if you don't know what it means to commit your life to Christ as your personal Savior, and you want to, I want to invite you guys to raise your hand. Everybody's eyes are closed right now. Eyes are closed, heads are bowed. I just want to invite you to raise your hand. Nobody will be looking. This is a commitment that you are making between you and God. I see that hand. I see that hand. That one. And that one. We have found hope in Jesus Christ. That's what this night is for. Is for us to share the hope that we have found in Christ in you. Keep those hands up. I'm gonna wait a couple more seconds. I wanna invite you guys, if this is the moment that you need right now to give your life to Christ, to accept him as your Savior, just raise that hand. Raised, eyes closed. Those of you with your hands raised tonight, I want you to pray this prayer with me. There's no magic in this. This is just you declaring to God that you are choosing to follow him. Heavenly Father, God, I'm a sinner. I'm a person that does not deserve you. God, I come to you broken. And I come to you as a person that needs you. I pray that you forgive me of my sins, forgive me of all the wrong that I have done. And I pray that I have a new relationship with you, God. I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I thank you that you came, lived a perfect life, and died on the cross. In your holy name, amen. Those of you that just gave your life to Christ, hallelujah. I'm so psyched for you guys. Everybody, I'm going to invite you to keep your eyes closed. Now, maybe you're here tonight. Maybe it's your first time back to primetime in a long time. Maybe you're here tonight and you're just like, hey, my hope's awesome. I want to come to this. And you've given your life to Christ before. You know what it means to be a follower of Christ. But maybe you haven't been living your life in that way. Maybe you are messing up with your boyfriend or girlfriend. Maybe you are drinking. Maybe you're doing whatever. And you know that's not what God wants for you. If you're here tonight and you have declared that you are a follower of Christ, but maybe you need to recommit your life to Christ. Maybe you need to remind yourself what it means to obey Christ in all aspects of my life, not just on Sunday evening or Sunday morning. If you need to recommit your life to Christ tonight, I want to invite you to raise your hand. Maybe you're a follower of Christ, but you haven't been living your life that way. Now is your chance to choose to obey God. To choose to obey Him in a way that makes you uncomfortable. In a way that is difficult. Just raise those hands. I see those hands. We're going to keep this going for a little bit longer. But if you need to recommit your life to Christ to obey Him, just lift that hand up. A couple more seconds. Those of you that have your hands raised right now, those of you that are committing to obeying God on a whole new level, I'm going to pray with you right now. Heavenly Father, I thank you for these people that recognize that the way they've been living their lives is not what you've called them to, is not what you want from them, and they want to change. They want to choose to obey you in every aspect of their lives. Pray that you give them the strength and the power to do that. In your name I pray, amen. Now, I want everybody, keep your eyes closed. If you raise your hand to give your life to Christ for the first time or recommit your life to Christ this time, I want you to raise your hand again. Now, if you are a follower of Christ, I want you to raise your hand. I want everybody to open their eyes. This is your family now. This is your family that loves you and wants to be there for you. I want you guys to give each other a round of applause. This is incredible. Kayla and Joseph are going to finish out this song, and I just want you guys to spend time in worship and just recognize how incredible and glorious God is. After this, we're going to break up, and I'm going to give you guys a chance to pray. But right now, just worship. guys to go from this place tonight without talking to somebody. If you made a decision tonight, whether it is to give your life to Christ for the first time or to recommit your life to Christ to obey Him with everything you do, we have some incredible adult leaders that want to talk with you. They want to pray with you. I want to invite you guys to stick around. Please stay in here. Keep your friends here with you. Keep the person that invited you here with you, because I guarantee that person will want to pray with you. They will want to rejoice with you. At this point, I want to dismiss those that did not make a decision, or if they did not recommit your lives, I want to give you an opportunity to quietly step out of the room. And if you guys look to the sides of the room, we have adult leaders who are available to pray with you and to talk with you about whatever it is that you need. So I dismiss you guys at this time. Please, please, please don't leave this room without talking to an adult. They love you and they want to pray with you. I love you guys and I want to pray with you. So please see one of them.